Good morning. I had the opportunity to wake up earlier than normal, and I saw a beautiful sunrise, just gorgeous. I don't normally get up that early, but what a lovely day. A little cold, but beautiful. I have a few announcements. There are carryout connection Sunday school bags still available for pickup in the Narthex. And remember that our next in-person gathering is Sunday, November 6th at 9 a.m. And I have an announcement about a banquet to benefit the Worm Project. The banquet is on October 22nd at Franconia Heritage Restaurant at 6 p.m. Reservations are required by October 16th. See the flyer on the Health Ministry Bulletin Board. And for questions or reservations, contact Joanne Sine. Her email address and phone number are on the flyer. And finally, it's time to get acquainted with Pastor Dale. We are setting up a number of small person gatherings. There are sign-up sheets in the Narthex and in the elevator lobby. This is for about 6 to 8 people. It will be on Sundays in between the two services at 9 a.m. and also Thursdays at 5:30 for choir people and things that are happening to be there. Please do sign up if you're interested in a more personal conversation with Dale. And if you're also interested in hosting one, perhaps in your home, talk to Pastor Dale about what day might work for that. There's the next two Sundays and the next two Thursdays are listed, but we can go beyond that as well. And if this is the first time worshiping with us, please look for a little pew card with a mouse in it. Put your name and address in there and put it in a basket in the back. And that way we can learn more about you and you can learn more about us. And remember that no matter where you are and where you are in life's journey, we would like to meet you and share God's love with you. Now let's all take a slow breath and prepare for worship.
Good morning, church. Here we are, each one of us on life's journey. Today is the Sabbath. We've worked, we've engaged for 6 days, and today is the day that we pause, we rest, we reflect, and we worship God. So I invite you to bring your heart, your mind, your soul, and all that is within you as we worship Almighty God. Would you join with me now in our prayer of confession? Present and ever-listening God, we know what it is like to be an outsider. We know the feelings that come with being overlooked, excluded, or dismissed. And yet, we ourselves are prone to tunnel vision, limiting our circle of relationships to those who are safe, familiar, and like-minded. We confess that we have lost opportunities to make new friends, to draw the circle wider, and to experience the joy that comes with a generous spirit. Renewing God, replant within us the desire to reach beyond the self-imposed borders we place around ourselves and release us to reach toward others in love, gratitude, and joy. Help us to see the ways in which you are bringing your world ever so closer to your vision of the beloved community. Amen. We are wont to pull apart, to separate, to lose our way. And yet there is a God who has called us to make us whole. And when we confess our sins, that journey back to wholeness, that journey back to completeness unfolds. And so, people of God, know that you are forgiven, that you have been set free, that you today have been made new. Praise God. Amen. Our reading from the Hebrew Scriptures, the Old Testament, comes from the book of Jeremiah. There are two very major events in the life of Israel. One is the Exodus. When the people of God were liberated from bondage in Egypt. And the second major historic event was what we call the exile. When the Empire of Babylon came in and destroyed Jerusalem and southern Israel, taking Jews with them back to Babylon. So hear these words from Jeremiah to those people who had been exiled. These are the words of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the remaining elders among the exiles and to the priests, the prophets, and all the people whom Nebuchadnezzar had taken into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat what they produce, take wives and have sons and daughters, take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there and do not decrease, but seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf. For in its welfare, you will find your welfare. From the Gospel according to Luke. Hear these words. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priest." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. And then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." The word of God for the people of God.
I'm going to invite the children to come up, and I know there are 2, and they promised they would come, or at least their mother promised they would come. And if there are more, please come. I have to sit on a stool because if I get on the ground, I won't get back up again. So I wanted to talk to you about traveling, being away from home. So have you gone on a vacation anywhere? Where did you go? Canada, California, lots of places. Anywhere else? How about sleeping overnight? Have you slept overnight anywhere?
Yes.
Where?
At your grandma's house.
Do you do? And at your friend's house. Okay, when you do that, do you bring anything with you? What do you bring?
Like a pillow.
A pillow?
Like a sleeping bag.
A sleeping bag? Make some clothes to change into. Now my kids, it's a long time ago, they bring things like a teddy bear. Do you ever bring anything like that? Yeah. My son, this is not his teddy bear. I couldn't find it. But my son's teddy bear had no stuffing in the head at all because he loved it so much. So it was very loved and very worn, and he took it everywhere that he went. And my daughter had a blanket. And it's really a mess at this point. I think she still has it. But anyway, I bring a pillow. I always bring my favorite pillow because it's just better to sleep with when it's your very own, isn't it? So I think lots of times when you go somewhere, whether it's a vacation or a strange place, or even if you go to your grandma's a lot, you still like to have something really comfortable that makes you feel maybe less scared, or it's just very usual. And I think we can think about, besides bringing something that we love with us, if we bring God with us, God can make us feel more comfortable. He's always with us. If we're scared, we know we can talk to him and we can pray to him. And whether it's good, we can talk to him about things that are good, but we can also, if we're a little worried, he's another comfortable thing that we can always have with us. Okay, remember that? So let's do a little prayer and then we'll do the Lord's Prayer. Dear God, thank you for being with us today. Thank you for being with us tomorrow and the next day. And thank you for being with us no matter where we go. And hear us as we pray the prayer your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thanks for coming up so I wasn't alone. And you can go back to your parents.
Thank you.
It's great to look out and see you all. Thank you for being here, for responding to the Spirit in your life, for making the journey here to be together, to be in community. I do want to mention that Pastor Addie is enjoying a well-deserved vacation. And we hope that she soaks in every bit of sunlight there is today and for the next series of days while she enjoys that very well-deserved vacation. Many of you know that this past Wednesday was the high holy day in Judaism called Yom Kippur. Well, for the first time in 3 decades, Rabbi Pinchas Goldschmidt, the chief rabbi in Moscow, was unable to prepare or lead services at the Choral Synagogue for Yom Kippur. You may know that Yom Kippur is the holiest of days in Judaism. It is the culmination of 10 days of individual and community repentance. And Rabbi Goldschmidt is usually involved in weeks of preparation for these high holy days. But this year, he and his wife felt they needed to leave Russia. As Rabbi Goldschmidt writes in the New York Times, and I quote, "This will be our first Yom Kippur in true exile from the place we called our home for 3 decades," end quote. That's because after Vladimir Putin's invasion of Ukraine, everything has shifted. Rabbi Goldschmidt explains that Putin's authoritarianism has become intensified. Protesters are being arrested, independent media outlets are being silenced, and priests, imams, and rabbis are being pressured by the government to support the Russian military. Word came from the Russian government to the century-old synagogue building where Rabbi Goldschmidt presided that he was expected to support the war or else. This would not be the first time pressure from the Russian government would come down to this Moscow synagogue. It happened back in 1933 when a predecessor of Rabbi Goldschmidt, Rabbi Medalia, whose preaching was being monitored by the Russians, was later arrested and shot by the secret police. For as long as human communities have existed, there have been exiles, those who have been forced to leave a particular place or who have been banned from entering a particular place. It happened in 586 BCE when the Babylonians stormed Jerusalem, surrounding the region, carrying off to Babylon the best and the brightest Jews. while leaving behind the weak, the vulnerable, and the poor. To survive in a place that had been entirely decimated. This morning's reading from Jeremiah comes in the form of a letter to those who are in exile in Babylon. And naturally, all the hopes and aspirations of the Jews who were living in Babylon were aimed at returning home. And eventually, that return to Jerusalem would happen. But in the meantime, writes Jeremiah, those exiles were to seek the welfare of the city of Babylon and to do everything that they could to make life more humane for themselves and for all the citizens of Babylon. Even though you feel like a stranger in a strange land, wrote Jeremiah, I want you to live as if you are home. Centuries later, when Jesus was making his way to Jerusalem, he was going through a region. And the scripture suggests that it was an in-between place. The location is not clear. However, upon entering that village, 10 lepers called out to Jesus. They had to keep their distance because they were excluded from the main flow of society. Yes, they were exiles. They were considered contaminated people, often forced to live in isolation. And many lepers formed colonies, but never were they fully included, never fully embraced, never fully loved. That is until Jesus pronounced that they should go and show themselves to the priests, because Jesus had declared them clean, made them clean, made it possible for them to rejoin the larger society. And for those lepers, Jesus had bridged the gap between being in exile and being at home. Exile is a very harsh reality. It is usually associated with how one group forces another group out of its natural and rightful place, limiting their access to the whole of society. Vladimir Putin's apparent goal, if he had things go his way, would be to annex all of Ukraine. In reality, he wants to force Ukrainians into exile. He wants to strip them of their independence and their rightful place in the world. No doubt. Somewhere along life's way, you also have experienced exile. It may come in a very mild version. It could be that friends have decided that you no longer fit into their social network. Or you may have experienced work colleagues who, for whatever reason, no longer exude warmth and welcome, but instead leave you feeling isolated and confused. Some of you have been left exiled by your families. And there are fellow citizens who, for example, have come to believe that same-sex marriage should no longer come with all the rights of any other marriage. We live in a land where people experience exile. And we know what it's like. We no longer are welcomed. We are no longer invited. We're no longer included. We're no longer valued. Just like the Jewish exiles, who were carried off to an unfamiliar land, cut off from their homeland, cut off from the entirety of their people, customs and way of life. You and I know the hurt and the pain and the disorientation that comes with exile. Which is even more reason that when you and I are feeling that, feeling excluded, feeling left out, that we should continue to seek goodness, that we should seek the common good, and we should work with those who are feeling hurt and those who are marginalized. For the most part, leprosy is no longer the dreaded disease that it once was. But today, there are other kinds of diseases, social diseases that seek to divide, that seek to diminish, and which seek to disrupt God's vision of wholeness and oneness and community. And even when we are excluded, exiled, we are still called to live out a commitment to love and serve others. That's what makes Christians distinct. Of the 10 lepers who were made whole by Jesus, only one returned to him to give Jesus thanks. Only one leper, a Samaritan, an outsider, a foreigner, only he understood what it took for Jesus to make him whole. To comprehend this act on Jesus' part, to span the divide between outsiders and everyone else, to cross that divide between Samaritan and Jew. So maybe this work of coming together in our communities doesn't happen by focusing on differences. Maybe it happens when we realize we're all the same, that we understand what it means to be exiled and left out, that we understand what it means to be separated, when what we really want is to live together. And that is good news. Amen.
Thank you.
We have a few concerns for this morning. Jean McKinstry Rogers had a new heart valve recently put in, and it is leaking. So prayers for her as she heals. And we have continued prayers for Alan Johnston. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we admit that we have allowed doubt to settle into our hearts. The uncertainty in this world and our concern for the future has caused our focus to stray from you. Lord, forgive us. Help us to delight in you. Today, as we walk through the seasons of unknown help, of the unknown, help us to see you. Lord, when we are uncertain about what we should do, show us your ways. When we don't know which way to turn, teach us and show us. In everything we do, we ask you to guide us. Encourage our hearts with the truth of your word. You are with us. We are yours. You will strengthen us. You will help us, and you will hold us. As we look at our circumstances, help us to be overcome with your peace. Be with Jean and be with Alan. Thank you for your faithfulness. Remind us of your faithfulness to us. Remind us of those moments when your hand was clearly present in our life. We praise you for your presence, and we put our trust in you. When we are afraid and when anxiety is great within us, your consolation brings us joy. You sustain us. You give us a peace unlike the world. You relieve all our fears. You know our name and the beating of our hearts. Listen now to those silent prayers on our hearts. Your eye is upon us and you smile upon us. Thank you, Lord, for your peace, grace, love, and faithfulness as we navigate each day seeking your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'd like to invite Karen Methley to come forward at this time.
The end of the last hymn we sang just said, "And all our stewardship began." I think that was my cue to come up. The Stewardship Committee has selected a very appropriate theme this year with a covenant campaign. With faith, we move forward. It is a positive statement in difficult times, as there is much to concern us as a congregation. We are still dealing with a pandemic. Yes, it has lessened, but it still causes difficulties and could transmute to cause havoc anew. We had to deal with the retirement of Reverend Sue after her 42 years of service, and then tragically her passing. We must face the challenge of securing a new senior pastor. And we must face increasingly difficult economic times like high inflation and possibly a recession. How can we face all this? With faith, we move forward. Certainly, faith is key. And of course, we should want to move forward, but don't forget that simple word, we. We means all of us making up this congregation. Much is needed for us to do to move forward, but quite frankly, your monetary support is needed as well. So I ask you to participate in this year's Covenant campaign. Those of you who usually do, and those who have not done so. Prayerfully consider how you can support the ministry of St. John's. Then complete the covenant card and return it. You can mark a specific amount of your support, and if you can, that's great. But if not, just simply mark, "I will contribute as I am able." I hope that by worship on November 13th, there will be a huge pile of those covenant cards on the communion table to dedicate. It's a visible sign of our commitment. And if so, my friends, it will be possible that with faith, we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. We have been given so much. We are so blessed and so fortunate. And part of living life to its fullest is to give back, to give to God so that God can continue to unlock this vast reservoir of love for the world. And so I invite you now to share your tithes and your offerings. And if for some reason the plate misses you, or you miss the plate, you are always welcome to come up here following the service. That gift is precious, and it is blessed. O gracious God, take these gifts. Use them in ways we will never fully understand. May they reach to the edges of your world with love, hope, and grace. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
I want to remind each one of you this morning just how precious you are. The world may not tell you that, but you are precious, you are important, and God is with you. So as you move out today, may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may God give you peace today, tomorrow, and forever. Amen.